Welcome everybody. We are discussing the chapter Animal Kingdom. This is the chapter 4 of class 11th biology. In our previous three sessions, we have discussed up to phylum Platyhelminthes, phylum Aschelminthes or Nemathelminthes, phylum Annelida. Today in this session, we'll discuss the phylum Arthropoda, phylum Mollusca and phylum Echinodermata. Let us start our discussion with phylum Arthropoda. So let us discuss the characteristics of Arthropoda. Remember, this is the largest phylum of Animalia, which includes the insects. The major animals of this phylum are the insects. But other than insects, other animals are also there. But the dominant group is insect. Over 2/3 of all named species on earth are arthropods and they have organ system level of organization. As you know, starting from the Nemathelminthes, the system or the level of organization becomes the organ system level of organization. That means the organs are associated together to form specific system which performs specific function. The body is bilaterally symmetrical. You know the meaning of bilaterally symmetrical. That means the body can be divided into two equal halves in one vertical plane only. Body wall consists of three layer, ecto, endo and mesoderm. So it is triploblastic. Body is segmented and coelomate animals. So annelid onwards, all animals are coelomate. They are having a true coelom. Okay. The body of arthropod is covered by chitinous exoskeleton. Take the example of cockroach, which is the most common type of arthropod that we see. They have a hard, the body is covered by a hard covering that is called chitinous exoskeleton, which provides support, mechanical support to the body. So chitin is a type of polysaccharide. So that exoskeleton is made up of the chitin, a polysaccharide. The body consists of head, thorax and abdomen. I will show you the picture so that you can understand very clearly. They have jointed appendages. That's why the name of this phylum is Arthropoda. Arthros means joint, poda means appendages. So since all the organisms, all the animals included under this phylum are having jointed appendages, so they are called Arthropoda. So the common example, as I have told you, cockroach. So here you can see that this is the structure of cockroach. This is the covering of the cockroach, body of the cockroach, and that covering is made up of chitin, a hard substance. It is not soft like the muscles. So that chitin is a polysaccharide, as I have told you. And also I told you that the body is divided into three parts. Head, this you can see, this is the head, then thorax, then this part is the abdomen. So this is the thorax. This triangular portion is thorax. Then this is abdomen. And you can see the appendages are here. This is the appendage. These are the appendages. And here also, these are also the appendages of the mouth parts. So this is the head of the cockroach. So these are the appendages of mouth parts, which forms the mouth parts. So here you can see that there are so many joints in the appendages. That's why they are called arthropoda. Arthros means jointed and podus means appendages. So these are the mouth parts of cockroach and this is the posterior end of cockroach And here you can see that this is male cockroach and female cockroach. They can be distinguished by the presence of a specific structure that is called anal style. So this anal style is present in case of male cockroach, which is absent in female cockroach. So here in the diagram, you can see very clearly there are two outgrowths, extra outgrowths present in male cockroach. Okay. So let us discuss the respiratory organs in cockroach. The respiratory organs may be gills, book lungs, or tracheal system. So tracheal system is the excretory system in cockroach. But book gill and book lungs are present in other members of the phylum Arthropoda. So here we will see the picture and discuss one by one. So here you can see in case of cryfish, which is called shrimps. So they have layers of feather-like gills. So here you can see these are the gills. These are layers of gills are there, which are feather-like. Okay. So these gills are called book gills. They are arranged like the pages of a book. So book gills. Okay. So next come to book lung. Book lung are present in the spiders. So book lungs are the folded structures which increase, and these folds increase the surface area for exchange of the gases. Okay, so this is the structure of book lungs that is present in the spider as the respiratory organ. Then coming to the insects like cockroach, grasshoppers, honeybee. So in all insects, you can see that there are some exterior pores called spiracles, which are present on the abdomen. So here you can see this is the structure of the insect, a faint structure. But here the tracheal system is highlighted, the tracheal tubes. So here you can see the small pores are there. These pores are opened into the tubular structures called tracheal tubes. So through this opening, the oxygen and carbon dioxide are exchanged. Then the oxygen is carried by the tubes and directly the oxygen comes in contact with the tissues or the cells present in the body cavity. So what are the respiratory structures? That is book gills, book lungs and tracheal system. I hope it is clear to you. Now circulatory system. The circulatory system in Arthropoda is open type. As you know, in case of open type, there is no blood vessels. There are sinuses. The body is divided into chambers, that is called sinuses, and the blood from the heart is pumped out into the sinuses directly, and the tissues and cells are bathed in the fluid, that is the hemolymph is the circulating fluid. So here this is the case of cockroach. So you can see this is the heart, and this heart consists of 13 chambers, 13 chambered heart. Then you can see on either side of the heart, a special type of muscle is present, that is called alary muscles. Okay. So when the body of cockroach is divided into three sinuses, and when this heart pumps the bloods are opened into, the bloods are released into the body cavity, and directly they supply the materials to the tissues. So here the blood is not transported or circulated through the blood vessels like artery, veins and capillaries. That's why they have open type of circulatory system. Now let us discuss the sensory organs. So they have sensory organs like antenna, compound and simple eyes, statocysts, which is the balancing organ. Okay. I'll show you one by one. So So here you can see, this is the head of a prawn. So this is the highlighted view, the magnified view of the prawn. So here you can see the prawn has the simple eye. The simple eye are very small and they are non-functional. Simple eyes are very small and non-functional. But here you can see very big compound eyes are there. So these are the compound eyes which are having thousands of millions of facets, small songs, chambers. Okay, but the compound eye is the functional eye and they have mosaic vision. That means whenever they see any object, it appears like the mosaic, the arrangement of the mosaic on a surface. Okay, so they have, their vision is mosaic vision. So the insects or the arthropods are having a very specific type of vision that is called mosaic vision. So this is a sensory organ. So you can see this is the photoreceptor. Eye, it is meant for vision, so it is a receptor organ. So this is a type of sensory organ. Now come to another balancing organ. This is also seen in case of shrimps as well as in prawn. So here just near the eye, compound eye, the statocyst is present. There are two statocysts in one organism. So these statocysts are the balancing organ. As in case of human being, the balancing organ is present in the ear. So similarly, they have also a balancing organ. So here the highlighted view of balancing organ is there. So here the balancing organ consisting of ciliated sensory neurons, and inside this statocyst a fluid is present, and inside the fluid the particles are present called statolith particles. So these such statolith particles along with the sensory neuron maintains the balance of the body. Then come to the antenna. So here you might have observed the antenna of cockroach. It is a jointed structure. Very small segments are there in each antenna. This antenna is also a sensory organ, and the antenna helps the organism to know the direction in which they are moving. So besides the antenna, they have anal cerci, which is also a sensory organ. Okay, now we'll discuss about the different types of mouthpieces. So the arthropods take their food by different methods. So here I have shown the picture of different types of mouth parts. So this is the chewing type of mouth parts, which is seen in case of cockroach. Okay, then you can see the piercing or sucking type of mouth parts, that is seen in case of mosquito. Then siphonic mouth parts, that is seen in case of flies. And here you can see sponging mouth parts, that is seen in case of some of the grasshoppers and other insects. Now let us discuss the excretion. The excretion takes place through the Malpighian tubules. Let me tell you what is Malpighian tubules. So this is the digestive system of the insect, that is cockroach I have taken here. So this is the digestive system, and in the digestive system, let me tell you one thing, they have a bulbous structure that is called gizzard. So in the gizzard, the mechanical digestion of the food takes place. Now here in the intestine, that is the midgut, which is called midgut. In the midgut and the hindgut, in between the midgut, this is the midgut and this is the hindgut. At the junction of the midgut and the hindgut, some very fine fibrillar structures are there These are the tubular structures. These are called Malpighian tubules. So these Malpighian tubules are the excretory structures or excretory organs in case of arthropods. The Malpighian tubules absorb the nitrogenous waste from the body cavity and then they send it to the intestine. And from the intestine, along with the fecal matter, it is removed through the anus. Okay? So, this is how the excretion takes place in arthropoda. Now, let us discuss the reproductive system. The almost all the arthropods are dioecious. That means male and female sex are separate. And the fertilization is internal. It takes place inside the body of a female animal. Okay. So, here you can see this is the here two diagram I have shown you. The first one is the male reproductive system, which consists of the testes and other structures. And the testes produces the male gamete, that is the sperms. And here in the female reproductive structure, here are the ovaries. So here two big ovaries are there. The ovaries produce the egg. Okay. Now these arthropods, they show sexual dimorphism. That means the characters they have by which the male and female can be distinguished morphologically. Morphologically the male and female can be distinguished. How? So here in case of male cockroach, there is anal style. Anal style is present, that outgrowth is present here. This is also known as caudal style, but this caudal style is absent in case of female. By looking at the presence of or absence of the caudal style, we can distinguish the male and female arthropods. Okay, and these are mostly egg-laying, so they are oviparous. Development may be direct or indirect. So when they are indirect, they involve the larval stages. Now we'll discuss some economically important insects. As per your textbook, there are three economically important insects, that is Apis, different species of Apis, honeybee, bombyx, silkworm, commonly called as silkworm, lacifers, commonly called as lac insect. So, we will discuss the economic importance of these three insects. So, honeybee, they produce the honey and the bee wax. So, what are the uses of honey? The honey is rich in energy. They provide instant energy when we consume honey. The honey contains sugar, minerals, enzymes, vitamins and minerals and also pollens. And the honey can be used as antiseptic, which contains the formic acid as the preservative. And the honey act as the blood purifier, cures cough, cold, sore throat, ulcer of tongue, stomach and intestine. Okay, and beeswax is used in preparing the cosmetics. Now here we will discuss the importance of the silkworm, Bombyx mori. So as you have studied in class 8, fiber to fabric, there is in class 7, fiber to fabric chapter is there. In that chapter, you have studied how the silkworm produces the silk. Okay, so the silkworm is an important economic insect which converts the leaf protein. They feed upon the leaf protein and they convert this leaf protein into the silk protein. And the sericulture industry depends not only on a high quality of this silk, but also on the quality of leaves. So, if the quality of leaf is good, then the production of the silk that will be produced by the silkworm will also be of good quality. Then lac insect, what is its economic importance? Let us discuss. With increasing universal environment awareness, we are now very much aware about the use of plastic. So what is the harmful effect of plastic? So that's why most of the things which are prepared by plastic are now replaced by the lac. Because the lac are eco-friendly, biodegradable and self-sustaining natural material. Okay. And these lac insects are cultured on host tree which are growing primarily in wasteland. Okay. So, and promotion of lac and its culture can help in ecosystem development. And because the lacs are the produced by the lac insects and it is in place of plastic, we can use this. So it has high economic importance or economic value. And it is a source of livelihood of tribal and poor inhabiting the forest and sub-forest areas. So here I'll show you how lac is produced. More often we think that there is a most of us have the doubt that the lac is a product of plant. No, it is not a product of plant. Rather, the lac insect feeds upon the plant and like it grows on the it feeds upon the stem, and it like as in case of silkworm, the pupa is formed. So similarly, the saliva of this lac insect, it forms a covering around it. So here you can see the egg is laid by the insect. Then the the egg is covered by the pupa like structure, which is also called cocoon. And then that cocoon is formed by the insect's saliva. And that forms the lac. Then here you can see the larva after hatching. The larva are hatched out of the cocoon. And this cocoon is used as the lac. Okay. So in this way the lac is produced from the produced by the lac insect. Now we will discuss some of the arthropods which act as vector. Vector means they are the carrier of the disease causing pathogens. So here are the culex. Here is the culex. Culex carries the parasite Eucheria bancrofti that causes filaria. So all of us know that when a mosquito, particular type of mosquito bites, then the filaria is caused. So that mosquito is the culex mosquito which carries the Eucheria bancrofti. That is a one, very small ones which develops in the or reproduces in the lymph node of human being. Next, Anopheles, it is the very common type of mosquito that causes malaria and it is the vector for Plasmodium vivax. Then Aedes mosquito, and you know that it causes your dengue fever and it carries the viruses that causes the dengue. So here we discuss some of the arthropods and gorgeous pest. Okay, so here you can see very beautiful, they are very colored and beautiful and looking very gorgeous, but these are the pest. They eat the plant parts, especially the leaves, and they destroy the plant within a small period of time. Okay, they are called locusts. Now we'll discuss some of the arthropods which are the living fossils. So Limulus is the arthropod which is commonly known as king crab. It is a living fossil, and you know that living fossils are the organisms which have been present on the earth since years together without undergoing any changes or evolution. So the king crab, the scientific name is Limulus. It is a living fossil under the phylum Arthropoda. Now let us discuss the phylum Mollusca. Mollusca, it is the second largest animal phylum. Here are some of the examples of mollusca. Mollusca are terrestrial or aquatic. So if they're aquatic, they may be marine or freshwater, having organ level of organization. They are bilaterally symmetrical, cryptoblastic, and coelomate. So these features, the meaning of these features, already I have told you while discussing the arthropods. So here you can see some of the examples: phyla, the common snail, apple snail, helix, limax, dentalium, chiton, unio, octopus, and mytilus. Most of them are having an external shell, calcareous shell, which is very hard and that provides protection to the animal. And why they are known as mollusca? Because their body is soft. So it is derived from the term mollusk. Mollusk means soft. So since the animals are soft bodied, so the phylum is known as mollusca. And to protect the soft body, the hard covering or hard shell is present, that is calcareous shell. And the body is unsegmented, but the body is divided into three parts, that is head, muscular foot, and a visceral hump. I'll show you the picture so that it will be clear to you. A soft and spongy layer of skin forms a mantle over the visceral hump. The space between the hump and the mantle is called mantle cavity, in which feather-like gills are present. Gills are the respiratory organs, and they also help in excretion of these animals. Okay, so let me show you the diagram. The anterior head region has a sensory tentacle, and the mouth contains a file. File, you know, that to make the things sharp, we use the file having a rough surface. So they have a file-like organ that is called rasping organ or feeding organ called radula. Very, very important. So these features, children, you have to remember. The body is divided into three parts, that is head, muscular foot, and visceral hump. And there is a the soft and spongy layer of skin that forms a mantle over the visceral hump. The space between the hump and the mantle is called mantle cavity. In the mantle cavity, the gills are present, which helps in respiration and excretion. The head has sensory tentacles, and they have a feeding organ, very, very important, that is called radula. So here you can see the structure of mollusca. So this is the soft body of mollusca. So it has a distinct head. You can see the head has the tentacles, sensory tentacles, and here the different parts of the body are shown by different colors. So here you can see the visceral mass. This is the visceral mass which is present inside the shell, and this is the head which the animal can project out as per its wish. Now a muscular foot is there with the help of which it moves from one place to another place. When it encounters any danger, then the animal inserts its whole body inside the shell. So this is the unshelled body. So here you can see this is the visceral mass, which is soft, and the head and the foot. These are the three parts, and this viscera is present in the form of a hump-like structure. So it is called visceral hump. And in the viscera, as I told you, that a skinny fold is there, this blue color, that is called mantle. And in between the mantle and the viscera, there is a space, and that space is filled by a fluid, that is, it is filled by a fluid, and that cavity is called mantle cavity. And in the mantle cavity, you can see the gills. So this is the structure of a gill. Okay, and the gill performs the respiration and excretion. Okay, so here you very clearly you can see the structure of that the gills are there. Then the feeding organ, as I said, the radula is the feeding organ. So this is the mouth of the mollusca, and inside the mouth you can see the teeth are present. So this whole structure is called radula, on the surface of which the teeth like teeth are present. So they help in chewing the food and cutting the food. Okay, so I think it is very much clear to you. Now regarding the reproduction, they reproduce sexually. They are dioecious, that means the sexes are separate, male and female are separate. They are oviparous, they lay eggs, and the development is indirect. They include a larval stage, and this is the larva. And the larva is called trochophore larva. Remember, very very important, the larva of mollusca is called trochophore larva. Now these are the examples I have already shown you. The common name also I have given here, Pila, which is commonly known as apple snail. Pintada, it is the pearl oyster. Then sepia, cuttlefish, loligo, squid, octopus, common name is devilfish. Afflicia, common name is sea hag. Dentellium, the common name is tusk seal. It looks like the tusk of elephant. Chitoplura, it is its common name is chiton. So these are the examples of some of the common examples and their scientific name and common name. Okay, now let us discuss the phylum Echinodermata. These animals have an endoskeleton of calcareous ossicles. Their surface is very rough, spiny. Echinus means spiny, dermata, derma means skin. Since their skin is very hard and spiny, so they are called echinodermata. And all the echinodermata are marine, and they have organ system level of organization. The adult echinoderm have the radial symmetry. Here you can see, this is the adult one and this is the larva. So the larva has bilateral symmetry, but the adult, here the adult is shown, it is pentaradial symmetry, you can see. So it has five arms. So you can divide the body of this animal into two equal halves in five radius only. So they are pentaradial, and the larva is having bilateral symmetry, very very important feature. They are triploblastic and coelomate animals. Now the digestive system is complete. They have a ventral and dorsal side. They are dorsiventrally flattened. So mouth is present on the ventral side or the lower side, and the anus is present on the upper side or the dorsal side. Okay, or you can say on the back of the body, the anus is present on the front side of the body or the lower side of the body, the mouth is present. The excretory system is absent, a specific excretory system is absent. Sexes are separate. Reproduction is only by a sexual method. Fertilization is external. It takes place outside the body in the water. And the development is indirect because they involve the larval stages. The larvae are free swimming. So the most distinctive feature of Echinoderm is the presence of water vascular system, which is not found in any other phylum. This is very very important, children, from the examination point of view and also for the entrance examination. And this water vascular system helps in locomotion, capturing the food, and also transport of food and respiration. So this is the picture which shows the water vascular system. Here you can see this is the dorsal side of the animal or the starfish, where the anus is present. Then this is the digestive system, which consists of stomach and other parts. The digestive glands are present in each arm. In each arm you can see the structure like this. So in the this is called water vascular system. So here the water vascular system is highlighted. This water vascular system has a single opening at one point, that is called madre porite, through which the water enters. Then the water is circulated throughout the body through a tubular system. So each part is having this structure. So these tubes. Then again this tube is branched and it is having the feet, that is some shack like structures called tube feet, and these tube feet are projected out. As the water, these shack like ampulla, they are called ampulla, the ampulla are filled with water and the water is again removed, the contraction and relaxation of these arms takes place and the animal can move. So these tube feet helps the animal to locomote or move. And since the water enters through the madre porite, it takes the food along with the water, then it transports the food. Since it is connected to the digestive system also, so after digestion of the food, the digested food is transported throughout the body. And it also helps in respiration, because the water that circulates throughout the body, it contains the dissolved oxygen, and the gaseous exchange between the body cell and the water takes place directly. Okay. Now here are the some of the examples of echinodermata. Asterias, commonly known as starfish. Echinus, commonly known as sea urchin. Antidon, commonly known as sea lily. Cucumaria, commonly known as sea cucumber. They appear like the cucumber. Ophura, they are commonly known as brittle star. So these are the picture of the diagrams of the examples, common animals belonging to this phylum. So here you can see this is the sea star, the most common one. Then here you can see the sea lily. It is looking like a flower. Okay. Then here you can see the Ophiuroderia. So this is brittle star. So it seems as if it will be broken, okay, if we'll touch it. Then Echinodia, so this is sea urchin, you can see it is like a cucumber. Okay, so you can see it's a structure like if you take the cross section of cucumber and the cross section of this sea urchin, then you can understand how why it is called sea cucumber. Okay. So I hope all these three phylums, that is Arthropoda, Mollusca and Echinodermata, all the characteristics are clear to you. And in our next session, we'll discuss the phylum Hemichordata and phylum Chordata. Thank you for watching the video till end. Please like my video and give a small comment. That will be a token of encouragement for me, motivation for me. And don't forget to subscribe my channel to watch the videos for of all the chapters of class 11th and class 12th too. Thank you for watching the video till end.